Hi everyone. In this episode, we're going to be looking at a way of using delegates that is conceptually very different from how we used them last episode. Let's consider a simple scenario where we have a game with a player class, an achievements class, and a user interface class. The player class has a die method, which we can imagine gets called when the player's health falls below zero. Now let's say that the achievements class wants to know when the player dies so that it can keep count for the die 1,000 times achievement or whatever. And the UI class also wants to know when the player dies so that it can show some sort of game over screen. To this end, we can add an onPlayerDeath method to both of these classes. The question is, how do we actually call these methods when the player dies? The simplest solution is to make sure that the onPlayerDeath methods are public, and then in the die method of the player class, to get references to the achievements in UI classes and simply call onPlayerDeath on those references. This is a tempting way to do it because it's so quick and easy, but there are some pretty good arguments against it. Mainly, it's simply not the player class's job to keep track of who wants to know when the player has died, and what if some other classes also want to know when the player fires a weapon, or kills an enemy, or opens a treasure chest? The player class could quickly become littered with references to other classes, obscuring the actual functionality of the player code. Furthermore, since the player class now references these other classes, it is dependent on their existence. We couldn't remove any of these classes from the project without breaking the player class. This makes reusing code quite annoying. You want to reuse your player code in another project, but first you have to weed out all of the references to different classes that don't exist in the new project. Ideally, what we want is for the player class, instead of individually informing other classes when the player dies, to simply announce when it happens. It is then the responsibility of any class that actually wants to know when the player dies to listen out for that announcement. So I'll remove the references I created in the player class and instead create a public delegate up at the top of the class, which is void and takes no parameters, just like the onPlayerDeath methods. I'll call this the death delegate. We can then make an instance of this delegate, so public death delegate, I'll call it death event, and when the player dies, we will invoke this delegate. It's important, before invoking a delegate, to make sure that it's not null. This is just to prevent an error from occurring in the case that nothing has been assigned to the delegate. In the achievements class, let's make a start method, which we can imagine will be called at the beginning of the game. Here we can get a reference to the player class and subscribe the onPlayerDeath method to the death event. Note the plus equals notation for subscribing a method to a delegate. When the player dies, it would also be good practice to unsubscribe from the delegate using the minus equals operator. Let's copy this over to the UI class as well. So now, when the player dies, the death event is invoked and all the methods subscribed to it will be called. This is fantastic, but there are two things that can go wrong. The first is if we accidentally write equals instead of plus equals when subscribing a method to the delegate. This will overwrite anyone else that has already subscribed to that delegate and they won't be notified. The second is that any class with a reference to the player can invoke the delegate by simply writing player.deathEvent. Everyone who has subscribed to that delegate will now mistakenly think that the player is dead. Of course, neither of these things is an issue as long as one is careful when programming. However, the last thing we need as programmers is to give ourselves more opportunity to screw up. This is where events come in. To make a delegate into an event, one simply adds the event keyword when creating the delegate instance. All of a sudden, classes other than the one in which the delegate is defined are no longer able to assign directly to the delegate. They can only subscribe and unsubscribe using plus equals and minus equals. Furthermore, they are not able to invoke the delegate. So you can think of the event keyword as simply adding these two restrictions onto the delegate. I'd like to mention two more things, actions and funks. These don't provide any new functionality, they're simply convenient shortcuts for creating delegate variables. They're both part of the system namespace, so you'll need to write using system to access them. So the idea is that in order to create this death event variable, we first had to create the death delegate to specify the return type and parameters. Actions and funks allow us to skip this step and go straight to creating the variable. So I could replace these two lines with public event action, death event. This is because action represents a void delegate with no parameters. The generic versions of action can be used to create a void delegate with a single or multiple parameters. Func can be used to create a delegate with a custom return type and no parameters. Func can also be used to create a delegate with a custom return type as well as parameters. This is done by specifying multiple types when creating the func. The last type specified will be the return type, and all the previous ones will be parameters. For example, creating a func of type int string bool is equivalent to making a delegate that returns a bool and takes in an int and string parameter, and then making an instance of that delegate. I hope you found all of this to be helpful. If you'd like to support these videos, you can do so on Patreon. Cheers!